thanks to all of you, and welcome to this wonderful forum, the World Science Festival show about mathematical genius. Tonight, of course, we are going to be talking about mathematics, and we're going to be talking about one math genius in particular. His name is Srinivasa Ramanujan, although you may hear him pronounced as Ramanujan or other things, because there is apparently some difference in the way to say his name. I'm going to try to stick to Ramanujan, but we will see how that goes. Ramanujan. I practiced so hard on this, too. He was, in any event, a young Indian clerk born in poverty, who one day, back in a different era, sent a letter full of equations to one of the most important mathematicians of the day, G.H. Hardy in Cambridge, England. And that letter led to an incredible series of events that is the topic of this movie that is soon to be released called The Man Who Knew Infinity. We're going to be viewing a few clips from the movie tonight. The movie is going to be released at the end of this month. We're also going to be talking to the film's director, and we have some incredible mathematicians to help guide us through the story and to explain why Ramanujan is so revered by mathematicians and how his mathematical insights continue to impact on our understanding today. As Susan mentioned, your questions are also part of this. We'll only have time for a few, but there will be index cards. So when they come around, just write your questions and pass them to the folks who are collecting them. Now, let's get right to it. Our first participant is Matt Brown. Matt is the director, come on out, Matt, and the screenwriter of the film, The Man Who Knew Infinity. Starring Dev Patel and Jeremy Irons, great cast. He also wrote London Town, starring Jonathan Rhys-Meyers, and recently adapted the script for an upcoming film about, well, another genius, maybe we could say, Ian Fleming, the author who created the iconic 007 James Bond. Also with us tonight, welcome to Matt Brown, first of all. Also with us tonight is Manjul Bhargava. Manjul is the R. Brandon Fred Professor of Mathematics at Princeton University, and he is the recipient of numerous honors and awards for his groundbreaking work in number theory, including the Fields Medal, which is popularly known as the Nobel Prize of Mathematics. Manjul is also an associate producer for the film The Man Who Knew Infinity. Welcome to Manjul. Finally, we welcome Stephen Strogatz. Steve is the Jacob Gould Sherman Professor of Applied Mathematics at Cornell University. Steve has a fan club here tonight.
Okay.
That's great. A renowned teacher, one of the world's most highly cited mathematicians. He has blogged about math for the New York Times and been a frequent guest on Radiolab. He is the author of Nonlinear Dynamics and Chaos, Sync and the Calculus of Friendship, and his latest book is called The Joy of X. Thank you. So these days, let's talk a little bit about genius. The word genius seems to be applied to just about anyone who achieves success or does something interesting. But the word genius has a very specific meaning. It's not just a matter of being really smart or really talented or really artistic. What makes someone a genius is the ability to grasp concepts much more quickly than the average person, and then to pull all of that knowledge together in a very unique way, making us see the world in a whole new light. The 18th century German philosopher Arthur Schopenhauer said, "Talent hits a target no one else can hit. Genius hits a target no one else can see." This ability to see a solution that no one else dreamed of is what ultimately defines a genius. Not to merely have an original idea, but a perspective that profoundly changes our understanding and causes us to question what we know or what we think we knew. A friend of mine who's a mathematician actually offers this. He said to me, "A mathematical genius is someone who can prove the unimaginable." So we're going to talk about math genius tonight. And before we dive into the particulars of that, let's make sure we understand some basic math concepts. And Steve, let me start with you. I know you spend years teaching this, but can you give us a really concise tutorial on formulas and proofs?
Okay. Well, let's start. So you say start basic. So there's 1 plus 1 equals 2. That would, I suppose, qualify as an equation. I'm not sure if I would call it a formula. I think of formulas as equations usually involving letters and numbers, something like when you learn the Pythagorean theorem in geometry in high school, a squared plus b squared equals c squared, relating to the sides of, you know, relates the sides of a right triangle to the length of the hypotenuse. Okay, but what's the real point about formulas? Not so much this mumbo jumbo I just gave about letters and numbers, but formulas are a particular kind of mathematical assertion. They say, this is true. And as soon as you make an assertion like that, that something is true, usually something surprising is true, that is the thing on the left-hand side of the equal sign is, I'm asserting the thing on the right-hand side. And it's usually not obvious that they're equal. And that's why proof comes in. Proof has two roles. First, to convince us that what we think is true really is true. But even more important, proof gives us insight. It makes us understand in our gut why it's true.
So formulas and proofs are the basic building blocks for what we're talking about.
Right,
here.
Right. You should think of the formulas as the facts and the proofs as the arguments or the reasoning.
Let's move on to something different. Manjul, number theory. Number theory, according to Carl Friedrich Gauss, who I guess is considered the greatest, one of the greatest mathematicians of all time.
Yeah, and certainly in number theory. Definitely.
In number theory, okay.
But in general, too.
He said, and I quote, mathematics is the queen of the sciences, and the theory of numbers is the queen of mathematics. Why did he say that, and what is it about number theory?
Well, number theory, just like we mathematicians always view mathematics as the most basic of the sciences, the most central of the sciences, in the same way, number theory is the most basic of the subjects in mathematics. So what is number theory? Number theory is, by definition, is the study of whole numbers. So the numbers that we count with, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. Of course, we also include 0, and -1, and -2, and -3, and so on. And those numbers together are called the whole numbers. And number theory is the study of whole numbers, of properties of the whole numbers, of patterns in the whole numbers. Number theorists love to study special sequences of whole numbers, like the odd numbers or the square numbers, and of course the prime numbers, which are probably the most important sequence for number theorists. The reason being that every whole number can uniquely be expressed by multiplying together prime numbers. So prime numbers are like the atoms of the number theory world. Prime numbers can be used to make any whole number. And so that's why prime numbers are extremely important to the study of number theory. And the other thing that number theorists love to understand is solving equations in the whole numbers. So for example, Stephen was mentioning a squared plus b squared equals c squared. That has solutions in the whole numbers, like 3, 4, 5. If you check 3 squared plus 4 squared equals 5 squared. Can we find all solutions in the whole numbers? Can we prove that they're all solutions? These are the kinds of questions that number theorists really try to understand. And the reason we think it's the most fundamental is that, well, counting numbers are what we use every day to count things. And we're trying to understand patterns in these whole numbers. To number theorists, we think that if there are other civilizations out there, the first science that they would be trying to figure out is number theory. That's why when we send communications to outer space, we always talk in prime numbers, because we figure any civilization in the world, that's what they're going to look at first.
And now we have it all reduced to little ones and zeros.
That's right, yeah. So we can write all the prime numbers in terms of ones and zeros, but that's exactly what's transmitted to outer space to try to find life out there. And that's exactly what happened on Earth, too. All civilizations, when they first started thinking about science, they started thinking about number theory. The ancient Egyptians, the Babylonians, ancient Indians, the ancient Chinese, the ancient Greece, they all came up with number theory as the first fundamental thing to understand, the numbers that we count with.
And these important words, concepts, number theory, formulas, proofs, were embodied in this man, Ramanujan, in a way that many people had never seen before. Matt Brown, what attracted you to him? And give us just a quick précis of his life in the film.
Well, I should first say that I came to the story through the wonderful book called The Man in New Infinity that was written by Robert Cannigal. And I was probably attracted more to it out of the human story, but we'll get to that a little bit more later. But understanding where Ramanujan came from, I think, is really important. He came from South India, from Madras, well, really from Kumbakonam, about 6 hours from Madras. And he had no formal education to speak of. He'd actually gotten thrown out of a high school and grammar school, I think, because he was so absorbed in his mathematics that he couldn't really pay attention to his other subjects.
He flunked out of college twice.
But he had no real teachers. He had one book called Carr's Synopsis, which I think was very important to Cambridge students at that time. In studying for the tripos examinations, which actually G.H. Hardy, the other character in the story, helped eradicate because he didn't believe in the standardized testing, but to that degree. But so this was a man who had no formal education, and he was left for basically being crazy. That's sort of how people perceived him. So eventually, he couldn't find any employment because at that time you really needed to have a degree. He didn't have one. He was eventually taken in to become a clerk at the Port Trust in Madras. And while he was there, he found a couple of believers in his mathematics and the potential of his genius. And they helped him write three letters to three different professors at Cambridge at that time, at Trinity College. And of the three, two of them decided that he was a crackpot and didn't even respond to the letters, and one of them, G.H. Hardy, took it seriously and staked his reputation on bringing him to Cambridge.
Well, let me interrupt you there. He was 26 years old at the time, if I'm not mistaken. I have 1913 is when he wrote the letter.
Right.
So he was 26. Mm-hmm. And we now are going to show you a clip from the movie about when G.H. Hardy received that letter.
Integrals, infinite series, God knows what else. Oh, excuse me. I always forget you don't believe in a supreme being.
Right.
This chap turns out to be genuine. You might have to reconsider.
Well, he must be genuine. Who'd have the imagination to invent all that?
Well, I'm rather flattered you thought I did. These two infinite series are the more intriguing.
Yeah, they defeated me completely. I've never seen anything like them.
Well, it's deceptive. I'll wager the hypergeometric series.
A great Littlewood stumped. He's Hobbes class, I'd say. Being inexperienced, I would very highly value any advice you give me. Yours truly, S. Ramanujan.
What does the S stand for?
You can ask him yourself.
You intend to invite him here?
Oh, no. Much better let him rot away in his office in Madras.
Ah, Mr. Ramanujan, there seems to be a letter for you, postmarked England, Cambridge, England, from a Mr. G.H. Hardy.
And Mr. Ramanujan's life is about to change. That, of course, was Jeremy Irons playing G.H. Hardy, Toby Jones playing his colleague, Littlewood. So, Steve, why did this letter so... why did Hardy invite him? What did they see in this letter?
Can I just say, I have not seen this movie, unlike the associate producer and the director. and I'm all choked up already. I mean, it is so moving. Really, it's magnificent. To capture that moment. In fact, I think the moment is even more intense, possibly, than can be conveyed, that what really happened, we know Hardy wrote about this, that Hardy sees these formulas, some of which he recognizes as the formulas at the cutting edge of math of his day. So he knows that this is not really a crackpot, clearly not. I mean, by the way, mathematicians like Manjul and I get letters like this frequently in all caps.
Cut out of the newspaper.
Yes, frequently sent registered mail. A certain amount of paranoia that the great secrets are being shared and we better not steal them and so on. So, you know, you get letters from would-be geniuses all the time, right?
All the time.
Yeah. but this one, I'm sure Hardy could have sensed, is the real thing. And then he says, in when he later wrote about this letter, that some of the formulas, and I'm quoting, completely defeated me. I think that's a magnificent phrase. I mean, here's the best mathematician in England. You have to realize this is not just a guy teaching at Trinity. This is the greatest mathematician in England, except for maybe his collaborator, Littlewood. And he can't understand these formulas. I mean, they completely defeated him. So he felt like he was seeing something from another planet. This was an intelligence that was alien.
You know, I actually saw a version of the movie, and what I started thinking of was back in the, I guess, 19th century, when white people sent from, English travelers sent from Australia the first skin of a platypus, and they sent it to the British Museum, and the wise heads at the British Museum held this thing up to the light. They were looking for the stitching marks because they didn't believe it was real.
Yeah.
They were like, where did they stitch that duck bill onto this fur skin? It couldn't possibly be a real creature. And I guess what I'm wondering is, how did, you're saying they'd never seen anything like this before.
Except for part of it. That's except the point, okay. That there was credibility.
So how did they know this was the real thing and not something ginned up? Or what's the moment of understanding
I think you heard it in the line from Hardy. He says they had to be true because no one would have had the imagination to invent them. That's his quote.
For a mathematician, those formulas were beautiful. I mean, when mathematicians evaluate work, it's often not in terms of just correctness, but in terms of creativity.
We were looking at those. Those are some of the formulas up there, and I don't know how much you can see, but there are symmetries in them. Even if you don't know math at all, you can see certain infinite combinations being repeated. Like at the top right, it says u equals x over 1 plus x to the 5th over 1 plus x to the 10th over 1. Can you hear what's happening? The 5, 10, 15. This is an example of what's called a continued fraction, and there's a certain pattern in it that you don't need to know anything to feel that pattern. And then he defines another one, v, with some other pattern, and then makes some combination of them that obeys yet a third pattern that shows all the whole numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, they're all there.
Your enthusiasm is clearly awesome. What Mr. Hardy was feeling at the time. Manjul, what are you looking for? How do you spot real genius as opposed to speculation in something like this and in those letters that you get?
Yeah, well, when you look at Ramanujan's letter, and that's really the case study in genius, because he starts off with formulas, as Stephen said, that were kind of standard for the experts at the time. And then you go to the next line, and there's even more symmetry and more beautiful things added. And Hardy can just barely see, okay, maybe I could understand it this way. And then another big leap, and it's just suddenly you've just jumped several decades. And then another big leap, and you're into the next century. And just this succession of how Ramanujan was making leaps that are way beyond what anyone thought was humanly possible.
You know what I think?
How do you distinguish? How do you distinguish between what he's doing that is book smart as opposed to intuition as opposed to guessing?
Well,
or does it matter?
I mean, I'm really reminded, if people here can remember the movie Amadeus, you remember the Salieri character, who is a very good composer in his day. He's Hardy. I mean, he's very good. He's one of the best living composers. And then comes this kid, and he is good enough to realize that he can't touch Mozart. So Hardy was good enough to see what was in front of him, a genius of the kind that
can recognize.
Yeah, I mean, Hardy's good enough. He's a very, very good mathematician, and he's good enough to see that this is something else.
What was the thing he said? Hardy said that if I was like a 30 Littlewood, or no, he was like a 10.
Oh yeah, later in his life, Hardy gave, when he writes about Ramanujan, he talks about how he ranked pure mathematical ability, and his own was 20, and yeah. Littlewood, his collaborator, 25, and then Hilbert, who was, you know, the person who really set the course of mathematics for a century, was 80, and he said, Ramanujan, 100.
Wow. Yeah. As we heard in the movie clip, Hardy was an atheist. How did we feel?
Okay.
How did he deal with the fact that Ramanujan was religious and he was a man who credited his ability to come up with his math formulas to a Hindu goddess?
Yeah, the first question that everyone wants to ask when he's coming up with things that you can't fathom ever being possibly conceived by a human, they would ask, well, how do you come up with this stuff? Both Littlewood and Hardy, in the movie it's also shown, they ask, well, how do you come up with this? And
first
his answer,
he says, I don't know.
Yeah, first he said, I don't know. And then of course he'd always be pushed on it. And the best explanation that he had was that Namagiri, his goddess, from the tradition that he comes from in South India, used to write these equations on his tongue when he was sleeping. And so, he would wake up and write them down.
Yeah.
Matt, how do you deal with that in the movie? How did you choose how to deal with that in the movie, this difference between Hardy and Ramanujan that way?
Well, it's what drew me to the movie in many ways, because these men were so absolutely different and yet needed each other. For Ramanujan, there's a famous quote, and it's that for him, an equation has no meaning unless it expresses a thought of God, which couldn't be any more profound and different than Hardy, who is an atheist. So it was something that this was a difficult relation for the two of them. I mean, for Hardy, we had the war that this is set against, and he had mathematics that consumed his life, and he didn't really have a place for the personal. And I think one of the main points of this movie on the human level is that it's about the cost that comes when people wait out of fear to connect in relationships. So that's sort of what this is about on a human level. And I think that within that, we find how he can come to accept the fact that Ramanujan saw mathematics intertwined with God. And you have to imagine that when he was growing up, he would write his formulas and he would work. He would spend many, many hours working in the alcove of a temple right down the street. And I mean, you can imagine as he's working on these formulas and hearing jatis and the whole bit. Religion played a great role in his life. Whether or not Hardy wanted to accept that, I think he had a hard time with it.
Since you brought it up, let me push you a little bit on this whole idea of Ramanujan being the outsider when he came to Trinity College and the obstacles, the prejudice he had to deal with. At one point, somebody calls him a raving lunatic in the film. How was that important to the story?
Well, I think it's intrinsic. I mean, it's a huge part of the story is the racism he had to deal with at that time. And I think Hardy also took a blunt of that as well, because I mean, it's 1913, it's set against the war, it's not a time, all these students went off to war to fight, and they wound up coming back, and many of them wound up dying right in the courtyard of the Wren Library, because Cambridge was turned into a hospital.
Just like in Downton Abbey.
Yeah, well, I guess. So there was a lot of resentment towards the very few Indian students that were there at the time that didn't have to go to war, which increased the racism as well.
As Manjul, as someone who is also Indian, how do you put your math and your religion together, and what do you see in him this way?
Yeah, well, I grew up in a very Indian home. Even though I grew up in the United States, I grew up in a very Indian home. I grew up vegetarian. In the movie, you'll see, but in Ramanujan's story, he was a vegetarian in England, which didn't exist at the time. And a lot of his suffering and malnutrition and difficulty in just sustaining himself came from the fact that the cuisine that he ate, when he did ask for vegetarian food, he'd end up with the blandest boiled vegetable, and he'd be asked to eat it, and he's like, how can anyone eat this? And so I also grew up in the United States in a small town in Long Island, and we were the only Indian family around. We were all vegetarian, and so this was the kind of issue that I often faced as well, being the only one of that culture in the community. But the world has become a lot more global. I can sympathize with the problems that Ramanujan had when he went to England, But I also know that what I faced is like a very small fraction, because it's a very global world now.
Right. It's a different century.
He had to break caste.
So I can sympathize.
He had to break caste. Say that, yeah.
He had to break caste in order to leave his home. But for him to be able to cross the sea was breaking caste, and which means that basically...
People there knew what he was getting into, and they wanted to protect him. So him getting permission to just leave India to go to England in the first place was a huge deal. But this was the only way that he could pursue his mathematics. His family finally agreed for him to go, but it led to some serious problems in other parts of his life.
So we've got this Hindu at this very Christian college. Mm-hmm. Steve, you...
There's an aspect of this that about a different kind of prejudice that I think... If you don't know this story, you might find it interesting about Hardy, the atheist, that even though he was an atheist, you know, he's the defender of this Hindu who is visiting and who he sort of has discovered.
Well, being atheist was also not very accepted at the time.
So that's right.
He could relate to Ramanujan in that way, because they were both outcasts.
Exactly.
In that sense.
Yeah. And there was another incident that I wanted to mention where an American Jewish mathematician by the name of Norman Levinson was... being considered for a job at MIT at a time when, this is now much later, say around the 1940s, when anti-Semitism was still rampant and people like Levinson couldn't get hired at MIT just for the fact of being Jewish. And so late in his life, Hardy was given this, he was winning all kinds of honorary degrees and various honors. And so he was brought to America to do some events at MIT. And the president of MIT is walking him around, showing him the campus and showing off the great institute. And Hardy keeps referring to it as a theological institute. And the president, Vannevar Bush, says, I'm not sure why you keep saying this. It's a technological institute. And Hardy says, well, why won't you hire Levinson then? So anyway, I mean, Hardy...
Right. Yeah. There you go. There you go. Let's talk a little bit about the nature versus nurture debate. And Manjul, I'm going to start right with you, because your mom is a mathematician, and she was your first math teacher, right?
And she's here today somewhere.
And welcome. All right. So one might make the case that it's nurture, not nature, or nurture and nature.
Yeah, I think for everyone, it has to be, it's a combination always. And for some people, it's one more than the other. For me, having my mother as a mathematician was obviously a great influence on me. She was my first math teacher. And although she never pushed me into mathematics, if I ever had math questions, and I always did, as she knows, she would answer some of them, but most of the time she'd be like, you have to figure it out on your own. You have to start from the basics and build your way up to that point. And Ramanujan, of course, was one of the heroes for my mother as well. And Ramanujan's story really resonated, that he started basically from zero. He didn't have a formal education the way other mathematicians did. He started from the beginning and made his own path to the theorems that he was coming up with. And so my mom was a firm believer that I should do the same, that I should start from the beginning.
So you're a combination. Matt, when you went into the movie, did you see it as nature, nurture combination, or pure chance?
I think it was really nature for him. I don't think there was a lot of nurture. And Hardy had once said that it was a bit sad, because had he had some education in the beginning, he wouldn't have maybe been so many years in the wilderness.
That's true. But yeah, people talk about it both ways with Ramanujan. If he had an education, you kind of imagine, amazing things he could have done. But on the other hand, some of the things that he discovered, he would never have been drawn in that direction had he not come up within himself and not have been influenced and led to it by the way modern education teaches you to think. So he had his own way of thinking, and that took him to places that a normal education probably would not have.
Which leads me to Steve, what's the takeaway here for contemporary parents with their children? And for teachers, how do you deal with this in the classroom or at home?
Nowadays we're told that grit is important. This is the term that's used all the time, that tenacity, a person should try hard, that everyone can improve, that if you exercise your mind, it's like a muscle, you can make it stronger. And there's a lot of truth to that, but I don't in my heart believe that can create genius. And even though I'm sure your mother you know, nurtured you nicely. I have a feeling you were a born genius.
No, I don't know.
I really don't. Sorry to do that to you, but really, I mean, does anyone seriously believe that a genius of the Ramanujan character or caliber can be taught? Don't you instinctively believe that there are certain people who are geniuses born and that it is nature? Now, you can, by having improper nurture, you can stifle a genius. I believe in that.
I was going to ask that when Manjul brought up what if he had been educated. Could Ramanujan have been stifled?
Yes, I believe that. I believe that. I believe you can be either through deprivation or through overly rigid or suffocating.
Yeah, very rigid
treatment. Yes.
I feel like very rigid curricula force masses to think in the same way.
Yes.
And so I think the one lesson that comes from Ramanujan's life about the modern education system, if there is one, is that gentle guidance is good. You shouldn't leave the kids just to run around and do nothing. But gentle guidance and creativity, rather than just robotically teach, these are the steps of solving this problem, memorize it, and then just do it blindly. If instead we had, this is the problem, figure out a way to solve it yourself, and you can give gentle guidelines.
And I think history shows that. I mean, if you look at the really towering geniuses, Einstein rebelled against the teaching that was very militaristic and strict.
Right.
I don't know. Is that true? How about Isaac Newton? Isaac Newton went through the system.
He went through the
system. But he was a very solitary figure. Did a lot by, so I don't know. I mean, are there
any geniuses? Well, let me take it a step further. We're using the word genius here. What's a math savant? And to what extent, we're talking about Rain Man here, the Dustin Hoffman role. He was a math savant. People who can recall numbers and facts with amazing accuracy. Where's the line? Manjul, you want to take that?
Yeah, often math savants are confused with math geniuses, and mathematicians don't often like to think of math savants as mathematicians, because mathematicians really do something different. Math savants have an amazing recall, a photographic memory sometimes. They can do huge computations in their head, given a computation. But mathematics is something that's way beyond computation. For example, computation can allow you to check whether a certain solution to an equation is true, but it doesn't tell you how to prove that you have found every solution. So when you're in mathematics, you want to know that. When Stephen was talking about equations before, what mathematicians try to do is prove that you found every solution, or prove that equation is always true no matter what you put in it. And no matter how big a number you put in it, you have to check infinitely many things. And so no matter how good a computer you have, including a human savant, they can't just check 10, 20, million, billion cases and know that that's always going to be true. You need a mathematician to have a creative argument to explain why this will continue to hold true forever.
That's, I think, part of what should be so inspiring about the title of the movie and the book, The Man Who Knew Infinity. I mean, the way you describe it, the computer can do finite calculations, but to truly know infinity, to know something will always work all the way out to infinity, seems to take, at this point, the human imagination or some kind of, I mean, I suppose you could automate computers to reason about infinity, but I'm not sure if we're quite there
yet. In the same
way
you could try to get computers to compose artistic, beautiful music or to make paintings. But there is that human ingredient that tells mathematicians, this is the thing that I need to try to understand and understand it to infinity. And somehow computers still cannot be taught to do that, not yet.
These are pure mathematicians too, and I think that was something that should be understood as well.
What's a pure mathematician as opposed to
practical,
or an applied mathematician.
Applied mathematics. It was, I mean, at the time, Littlewood, one of the characters you just saw in the scene, he had to got called off to war to go use his mathematics to solve the problems and intricacies of ballistics, which he was not very happy about because he was a pacifist. But it's something that these guys were artists, and that's what I really came to learn when I was dealing with this idea of genius, and it was a question I had to think about a lot in terms of this film, obviously. And I thought of them as artists, and that really opened up the whole thing for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, pure mathematicians and even applied mathematicians, they generally they think of their subject more as an art than a science.
It's a creative
Before we move, I do want to talk about art, but before we leave this area, what's the comparison, or where do you put Ramanujan, and where do you put the idea of schizophrenia, A Beautiful Mind? First of all, could you have made your film if A Beautiful Mind had not been made, do you think?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
I mean, in terms of the acceptance of what Hollywood was interested in funding.
Well, we weren't really a Hollywood film, so that was part of the thing. I was saying earlier backstage that we had been at one point asked if Ramanujan could fall in love with a white nurse, where you could have the financing for your film, and I said that's not going to happen. So, I don't think of this as much as a Hollywood film. I love the idea that there are more movies being made about arts and sciences, and I think it's incredible. And I wish that there will be more, and we're hoping to do more. But it's a constant challenge that way.
Bravo. Is there, all three of you, any comparison between Ramanujan and John Nash? Is there any point of comparison, or are we talking about two very different?
I think we can say they're both math geniuses.
Yes.
That's accurate, okay. But I think beyond that.
Right.
He wasn't this crazy guy, Ramanujan. He wasn't that person that you have to say is a crazy, you have to be crazy to be a genius. Was he a little bit strange? There was a time he had a few friends over and he was cooking dinner and he was very excited and he finally had some people over and he had some vegetables and he cooks dinner and they don't ask for seconds. Well, that was a problem. Ramanujan disappeared for 2 days. So what do you say about that personality? I don't know.
Because he was he felt he had let them down.
Shame.
Yeah, it was so ashamed.
So much shame.
Right.
Huh.
Got it.
Which is bizarre, but
yeah. But overall Ramanujan was a very sociable, well-liked guy. I mean, he was
According to the way you portray him in the film, mm-hmm. he was not asocial at all.
He was beloved back home. People missed him so much and his company, not just his mathematics. The people didn't understand his mathematics. They missed his other part of his right. personality.
Let's talk about the art part of it, because you've all touched on the fact that mathematicians are not they're geniuses, they're creative geniuses, and there is an art, there is an elegance, there is a beauty to all of this. Einstein took time off to play Bach, Mozart, and Schubert on his violin. According to a 2008 study, Nobel laureates in science are more involved in the arts than the average scientist, which is really fascinating. So maybe having a lot of interest can complement or spark other ideas. And Manjul, I want to go to you. First, I want to play some audio of tabla, which I know is one of your favorite things. And you can tell us how it relates to mathematics and to Ramanujan's story. Let's first listen to the tabla.
So actually the instrument being played is not the tabla.
Oh.
But it's very relevant to the story. So the instrument being played is called the tabl, which is an instrument that was played in the temples in South India. It's a South Indian percussion instrument. And actually it's very relevant to Ramanujan's story because Ramanujan did a lot of his work sitting in his hometown temple lobby. And he would sit there, and this is the music. This is the kind of music that was played. The tabla was the South Indian temple drum. And so this is the kind of background that he had when he was writing down some of his extremely creative formulas, some of which made their way into the letter that he sent to Hardy later on. The other connection of art with Ramanujan is that his mother was a Carnatic classical singer. So in this genre, she was a vocalist. And so Ramanujan really grew up with music in his home.
What can you say about that music and the patterns and the way that he came up with his formulas?
Yeah, well, if you've ever listened to percussion, Indian percussion, but either North Indian like tabla or South Indian like tabla or mridangam, the Indian rhythms are extremely mathematical, extremely intricate, extremely creative. And actually the South Indian drummers go through a lot of mathematical training besides artistic training in counting. So often they'll have five or six different phrases and they have 16 beat cycles and they need to fit those five and six into 16 in all sorts of improvisations that they come up with on the spot because they've had that mathematical training and that mathematical practice. And for me personally, so I grew up playing tabla. My mother also is a classical Indian singer. So that's a connection that we have. And so I grew up listening to classical Indian music as well in all its mathematical intricacies. And I grew up playing the tabla, which is why I recognized that wasn't.
Yeah, right. Well, could have fooled me. What about Sanskrit poetry as well?
Yeah, Sanskrit poetry as well. That's also one of the, a lot of the drumming traditions in India are based on the poetic traditions. And so this, that same aspect I was mentioning, that poets in ancient times would try to understand, if I have phrases of given lengths, how many ways can I fit them in into a given meter? If I have a meter that has follows a certain pattern, how many ways can I move it around so that it still satisfies certain constraints? And that all make those mathematical ideas that originate in ancient times in India made their way through into classical Indian music. And these are all things that Ramanujan grew up with in the home. So when we say that he wasn't nurtured mathematically, well, in some sense, he was.
Nice.
All these rhythms that he was hearing, his mother singing these classical tunes that are, again, the frequencies that are chosen in Carnatic music are based on very mathematical ideas. And so all these things, these creative aspects of mathematics were somehow in the background, even though they weren't explicitly so in a school system.
Mm-hmm. In your own experience, when you deal with your work, you have said that you prefer to focus on, quote, simple problems of timeless beauty, which you solve by developing elegant and powerful new methods. I'm always interested in people's use of the word elegant when it comes to a building, architecture, a mathematical formula. What does that mean, the elegance, and talk about it as an art form?
Yeah, so when mathematicians talk to each other, if you want to compliment a mathematician, you tell them that their work is elegant. That's what they want to hear. They don't want to even want to hear powerful. They don't want to hear that's a great formula or that's a complicated formula. They want to hear that the work that they did was elegant and beautiful.
Yeah.
Just like any artist, that's what they want to hear. And so what mathematicians, when they talk to each other, what they're really trying to attain is an artistic height, an artistic sensibility, and not necessarily something that's very powerful or something that's really...
Let me try to define it a little bit, if you don't mind.
Yeah, that'd be great.
I mean, because people may have no idea what we're talking about. How can math be elegant?
We say we recognize it when we see it.
Oh, yeah, we understand it.
Yeah.
So if I were trying to...
I mean,
it's like that obscenity definition, right?
Right.
What were you going to say, Matt?
It's hard for you to wrap your head around it. I mean, I've been around this story for so long now, and it's... I know that it's elegant. I know that Hardy was the master of that, and Ramanujan, he was in awe of, but...
So
it's still hard.
Let's see what you think.
We have a clip after this.
All right. There are a few ingredients that I think you may agree or disagree, but let me try. So one is economy of means. That is something that is very overly ornate and complicated. No good. That can't be elegant. It has to be crisp and economical, parsimonious somehow. It should be surprising. That is, there's something that gives a shock of recognition and satisfaction when you see it, but it wasn't obvious. There's something surprising, yet it's so clean and economical, and yet once you get it, it's inevitable. That is, you feel like, oh, I should have seen that. Because it's, so one of the great mathematicians, Paul Erdős, used to refer to certain proofs, you know, as, he would say, those are from the book, with a capital T and a capital B. And what he means, and he was a very atheist. In fact, he used to refer to God by all kinds of denigrating names. He would call God SF, the supreme fascist. But anyway, so Erdős, but still, Erdős believed that God kept a book with all the best proofs of the theorems. And so the highest compliment was that one was straight from the book.
Right. As if what you're describing is as if it could have been no other way.
Yes, exactly. That's what I mean by inevitable. And you know what? If this seems a little abstract, think about a good joke. Good jokes have this. A good joke is not a big, long story. A good joke is surprising, but once you get it, it had to be that way.
Just to give you an idea of what makes it hard to define. If you're not a mathematician, you can still think in terms of music. When you hear a computer-generated piece of music versus a musical piece by Bach or a great composer, you're able to tell. You can usually tell.
Let's put it this way. We can still tell. God knows what's going to happen in the future.
Right. And same with it's very hard to define sometimes. What is it that has that human quality, that beauty, that artistry? But with the basic things that you said, simplicity, surprising in its simplicity.
Yes. There was a formula in the original letter that Littlewood said it was algebra almost. It almost looked like algebra, like simple algebra, but yet it was something that had nuance to it that they mm-hmm. kept on.
Yeah, simple yet profound is something.
That's good too.
Let's go to the movie now. In the movie, Matt, you show how Ramanujan was inspired. Rather than methodically going through proofs, math was like an art for him as well. Let's take a look at this movie clip right now.
How did you know that theorem?
It came to me. Mr. Hardy, I don't understand why we waste our time doing all these proofs. I have the formulas.
It's not that I can't see what you claimed. It's that I'm not sure that you know how you got there. Or indeed that your claims are correct. There are subtleties which...
But they are right, sir. I have more important new ideas.
Yes, but intuition is not enough. It has to be held accountable. And a little humility would go a long way. Why do you think they want us to fail?
Because I'm Indian.
Well, yep, there is that. But also, because of what we represent. Now, Euler and Jacobi, who were they?
Mathematicians.
Just names to you. Euler was the most productive mathematician of the 18th century. Most of his work done after he was blind. Jacobi, like you, was snatched from obscurity and was almost as impressive as Euler. Now, I think you are in their class. What they had in common, what I see in you, is a love of form. It's all through your notebooks. Let me ask you something. Why do you do it, any of this?
Because I have to. I see it.
Like Euler. Form for its own sake. An art unto itself. And like all art, it reflects truth. It's the only truth I know. It's my church. And you... Just as Mozart could hear an entire symphony in his head, you dance with numbers to infinity. But this dance, this art, does little to endear us to certain factions who see us as mere conjurers. So if we are going to challenge areas of mathematics that are so well trod, we cannot afford to be wrong. I need you to attend your lectures, don't offend your professors, and keep doing your proofs. Otherwise, this experiment of ours will be doomed to failure. Come with me. I want to show you something. There are many ways to be honored in life. For us, being elected a fellow is certainly one, but in my humble opinion, to leave a legacy here at the Wren after we are gone is the greatest. This library houses the epistles of St. Paul, the poems of Milton, Morgan's Bible. But in my estimation, as a man of numbers, the pièce de résistance is Newton's Principia Mathematica. Now, just as Newton represents the physical aspect of our work, your notebooks represent the abstract. Took a long time for Newton to be proved, which is why we have an obligation to prove these. And if we do, I believe that one day, these notebooks will find their place here. Now, do you understand what's at stake here? Good.
Matt, the line in the movie is, you dance with numbers to infinity.
Well, yeah, I guess it goes back to what we were talking about with the art. I mean, that's what this guy was. He was an artist, and he was operating on a level that nobody else was. And Hardy is one of the top mathematicians in the world, and he recognizes it, and he's in awe, and he's comparing it. His potential with Newton, and I think it, in some respects, that's possible. I mean, I'm not a mathematician, but I think that's fair.
But you use, may I quote the quote you use at the beginning of the movie, the Bertrand Russell, which is, Bertrand Russell's also in the movie, I should point out. there is a character. Mathematics, rightly viewed, possesses not only truth, but supreme beauty.
It's hard to make a movie about mathematics when you're not a mathematician. So you have to find a way to relate on some level. And I think that the struggle that artists go through is something I could relate to. And as I got to meet other artists, such as Manjul, who's a mathematician, and Ken Ono, who was with us on set and is also a brilliant mathematician, I started to recognize some of the same qualities in them that you see in other artists that perhaps are easier to for us as laymen to understand, such as musicians or writers.
Let's go on to, we're going to look at another clip now, it was hinted at here. Ramanujan's ideas, which are left in notebooks, are still being explored today. And during his short life, he independently compiled nearly 3,900 results, mostly identities and equations, which we heard about earlier. Let's watch another scene from the movie, and then we're going to talk about that.
Ramanujan, we decided that for the good of everybody, you should attend some lectures.
But I'm here to publish.
Yes, all in good time, I hope. But first we need proofs of your work.
It's really nothing to worry about. It's simply a question acquainting you with the more formal methods that will benefit our future work together.
I mean, we need a common language. You wouldn't expect us to converse with you in Tamil.
No, but you expect me to speak English.
Quite. So, there'll be plenty of time for publishing.
I'm sorry, but with all humility, how does anyone know that? I don't want this to die with me.
I assure you it won't.
Thank you, sir. But I have much more to share with you. As I told you, the letter only contained a small sampling of my discoveries. You'll see, I have even found a function which exactly represents the number of prime numbers less than x in the form of an infinite series.
Exactly?
Yes, I thought if we were going to publish, it should be something groundbreaking.
Well, this is most unexpected.
Hardy, this will take a lifetime. Maybe two.
Manjul,
wrong about that.
Go ahead.
He was wrong about his prime number theorem.
That's yes, unfortunately. That,
yeah. Oh, okay, so it could be always wrong.
Not every genius is, you know, perfect.
So as I understand it, what's going on here is he's getting to the end and he hasn't done the roadwork. He hasn't proved how he's gotten there. What's the argument about whether he should have done the proofs or whether he should have just kept on with the answers?
Yeah, there's been a lot of debate about that, about whether he should have been allowed to run and just write one more amazing thing after another, and he could leave that with us as he has, and we can try to understand it for the next several centuries. Or we could slow him down by a factor of 100 and ask him to explain each step that he was going through. And as a result, we end up with 1/100th less work. And there's been a long debate about that, but which one should have been right. But you know, he was proving, you know, 100 theorems a day, finding 100 new formulas a day. Should we have changed that to just being one or two so that he conforms to the way that we need to understand things today? And
it's a very hard question, and I feel like I can argue both sides of it. Yeah. That on the one side, I feel people, and not just geniuses, but people should do what they do well. Like, leave them alone to do what you're good at. And in his case, he was, except for Euler, probably the greatest discoverer of formulas ever. I think those are the two. And in the history of math, nobody liked them. For visionaries, for discovering.
For just having that intuition of knowing It's just going straight to the formula.
Straight to the truth.
Without even necessarily needing to do those justification steps that people know.
Could they, if pressed, do all the steps?
Not necessarily. Euler could, but I'm not so sure that Ramanujan could, and I'm not sure that's a problem. But my other side says, yes, it is a problem, because math is also a social endeavor. It's not just about the truth. It's also about teaching and communicating. That's my communicating side. And now, he may not have been the best communicator or the best prover, and maybe it should be left to other people who are better or have more taste for that. And in fact, that's how it has played out. Other people have
proved other people's final solutions and prove and do the formula.
That's what's
we're still trying to do it.
There's a lot left of the
3,900. How many have not been proven?
It's probably half.
Whoa.
Yeah, he was way, way ahead. He's 100 years ahead of us.
We have a lot to still understand. But one thing I should mention is that when he was pressed to prove some of the things that he discovered, for example, his work in partitions, which is featured in the movie very prominently.
Can you give us a minute on partitions or
sure.
30 seconds?
Yeah, partitions is one of the most elementary things that he did, in the sense that you can explain it to anybody. He was studying how many ways can you take a number and divide it up into pieces. So, for example, if you want to break up 4 into pieces, you could do 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1, or you could do 2 plus 1 plus 1, or you could do 3 plus 1, or you could just leave it as 4. And so how many total ways can you break up 4? That's a question. How many ways can you break up a million, a billion? How fast does that grow, that function, where you're asking, so P of n is the number of ways that you can break up n. So how many ways can you break up a million, a billion? And the way that this function was growing, people had studied it for years and just couldn't see any what is the rate of growth that this is taking. And one of the things that Ramanujan writes to Hardy, he gives an exact formula for how it's growing. That had never been seen before. And it completely stuns Hardy. And for Hardy, this was the point at which he said, okay, I have to stop you. We have to explain this.
Yes.
Because this has been such an old problem. Everyone thought it was unsolvable. And here he is. He just gave the answer. How did you come up with that answer? I don't know. Navagiri wrote it on my tongue. And that was the point where he said, no, you have to explain this.
He does say, at one point in the movie, you have him saying, one of the questions is, how do you do this? He says, I don't know, it's all in my mind. I just imagine it all. So it's all happened, it's an interior monologue.
It's an interior thing. But in this case, Hardy really pushed it.
Yes.
And this led to their amazing collaboration, in which they introduced a technique of proof called the circle method, which is now the fundamental tool in the field of mathematics called analytic number theory. It's just completely transformed. So that's a case where his pushing Ramanujan to actually give the proof led to one of the most amazing proof techniques in the subject that has ever been introduced.
Yeah, and you have to see it in this larger context, that by forcing him to prove it, and not just him proving it, they proved it together using methods that other people, like Gauss, who you mentioned earlier, or Cauchy, had developed, a part of math called complex analysis that was probably something Ramanujan didn't really know and didn't have a chance to study. But
picked
that,
it up on the fly.
Yeah, okay, picked it up
entire,
quickly. Yeah.
Entire.
But still, yeah. By proving it, it's not just a matter of showing it's true. That's part of it. But it's also to share. That is, it lets the rest of the world follow the genius.
And as I said,
otherwise we can't understand him at all.
Right, and it introduced a technique that has now we've continued to use to solve many other problems, not just the partitions problem.
And so think of it this way.
Just that result, but it's led to literally thousands, tens of thousands.
Plus, if there's another little genius out there somewhere, or wherever, really, then by sharing.
His mother, point to his mother.
Okay, yeah, wherever she is, then. I mean, you have to think bigger than just Ramanujan.
Steve, it's too selfish. You've talked about the fact that Ramanujan had such a unique, intimate connection to numbers in a way that other people can't understand. Tell the 1729
Well, yes,
story.
Okay, so the math buffs in the room will know this story, but if you haven't heard it, in case you don't know, Ramanujan gets sick at some point because of, we don't know, probably malnutrition, maybe tuberculosis, some combination, but
both.
Anyway, he's in the hospital and Hardy comes to visit him. And on the ride over in the taxi, Hardy was in taxi cab number 1729. And he says, we know Hardy wrote the story, that it seemed inauspicious that this is a rather dull number, took it as a bad omen. And immediately Ramanujan said, oh no, on the contrary, it's a very good number. It's the smallest number that can be expressed as a sum of two cubes in two different ways. Which, if you're trying to follow that, by the way, I can tell you what he meant. 1728 is 12 cubed, plus 1 cubed is 1729. But it's also true that 10 cubed plus 9 cubed is 1,000 plus 729. That's also 1729.
So it's a magical number.
It's a magical number. And so Littlewood, I think,
he knows it's the smallest number that has that property.
Yeah, there's the smallest number with that property. And so it's I think it was Littlewood who said, for him, the whole numbers were like personal friends. He knew things about each of them.
What about in your life as a mathematician, Steve? Get personal here. To what extent does creativity play a role in what you do, in how you approach it?
It's very much a part of what I try to do. In fact, I was the weakest math major in my college. We had about 10 math majors at Princeton that year, and I saw a lot of kids much smarter than I was at solving problems. They had greater mathematical talent. I loved math very much, maybe more than some of them. But what I was able to do that I think helped compensate for my comparative weakness, and still is helping me, is I ask strange questions. That is, I see math, like in the movie The Sixth Sense, where the little boy says, "I see dead people." For me, I see math everywhere. And I see math in places where it's not conventionally seen. For instance, you remember the play, 6 Degrees of Separation, or the movie that we're all connected by six handshakes. Well, of course, the number six is a number, so there's math in that statement. What would the world have to be like that we're all connected by such a small number of steps? And it's not a question that the sociologists or the social psychologists had really thought about as a math problem, but with my student Duncan Watts, we realized this is a math problem, and by thinking about it, we were led to ask questions like, not just about 6 degrees of separation between people, but what about in the brain, where every neuron is only six synapses away from every other neuron? That is, this kind of connection between things like brain networks and social networks of people is now leading to new insights into schizophrenia, Parkinson's, and this is from a mathematician. So the point is that because math is everywhere, if you're willing to think, I don't want to use the cliche, think out of the box, but yes, it's a kind of creativity to ask strange questions. By the way, this is not the math of Ramanujan. This is not pure math. This is math in the world, applied math, the other kind of math. And there's plenty of creativity in that too. Just to finish with the thought there, that as far as how it's like art, when I was working on the question of 6 degrees of separation, we didn't try to map the whole social network of the world very literally, in the same way that an impressionist painter does not seek photorealism. We seek
pieces of it.
Pieces, the impression, the essence of it. And we made mathematical models, which in the world of applied math, the word for elegance, or the signature of elegance, is that you have made an elegant model that somehow gives you the picture of what's really happening without all the muckety, grimy details.
Isn't that what polling is all about?
Polling uses that if it's done right.
Exactly.
Yes.
If it's done right, yes. Let's move on. Sorry. Manjul, let me ask you to talk to us about legacy. What of Ramanujan's formulas, proofs that he came up with in the last century, where is it leading us today, and how is it shaping our future?
Yeah, well, we're still trying to understand a lot of it. But maybe to give you just one example, the letter that he wrote on his deathbed to Hardy was this. He was on his deathbed. He was extremely sick, and yet he was still producing these ridiculous formulas, and sending them to Hardy. And we still have that letter today. And in that letter, you know, he's trying to get a lot of his ideas out because he knows maybe he doesn't have that much time. And so in this letter, he writes some incredible formulas, and he describes one of the very important functions in mathematics are called theta functions. And in that letter, he introduces a concept he says he calls Mach theta functions, which have properties like these most important theta functions. And he predicts they will be just as important in mathematics as these theta functions that, mm-hmm. that had been passed on for decades and been used in every application imaginable. And people looked at this for maybe half a century, And they're like, well, it's clearly not as important as regular theta functions. That we don't even know what this means. What is he talking about? And it took 80 years, and there was a PhD thesis of someone named Zweigers in Germany. And he got to the bottom of what Ramanujan meant by this. And he gave an explanation of where Ramanujan was going with this. And he wrote his PhD thesis about this 80 years after this enigmatic letter that Ramanujan wrote. And now it's blossomed into a whole field called Mach modular forms. And now these Mach modular forms are coming up everywhere in physics. And there were some questions about black holes and string theory that had been open for so long. And we've now realized that exactly those formulas that Ramanujan wrote in this deathbed letter are what we need to understand
so
that problem.
So string theory, black holes.
And this is cutting edge. This is just in the last year that this has happened.
Yeah, this is brand new. So uncanny about it, I think, aside from the prescience to do this 80 years ahead, is that this is not like an impressionist painting in the sense that his work leads us to insights about the actual universe. That is, there's a kind of structure in the universe that is mathematical that is deeper than any creative human force. That, you know, I'm not saying it very well, but it's as if it's a very profound mystery how the universe can know math. Mm. How can it be built on math so that the things that he's seeing in his mind or that the goddess Namagiri is giving him on his tongue, 80 years later, are turning out to describe the structure of fundamental physics at the deepest level? How can that be? How can the world be built like that, if it is? I mean, we don't even know if this is correct yet, because we don't know if string theory is correct. But if it is, how spooky is it that this was anticipated on his deathbed?
And almost wasn't seen, right? Because that was the lost notebook, essentially,
yes.
Wasn't it? Which was, they called it the lost notebook because it was actually slated to be thrown out as rubbish from the Wren Library, and it was discovered the night before it was going to be thrown out by George Andrews. Which is just kind of incredible.
It would have been just a huge...
One more clip on this very concept. Matt, in this one, Ramanujan talks about the magical potential of numbers and of math to explain our world, just as you were saying. Let's take a look. This is the last clip.
Go ahead. You can look.
Please.
What does it all do?
It's like a painting, I think. Only imagine it is with colors you cannot see.
What good is that?
Not much for you, I'm afraid. But for me, it is everything. Maybe there is someone else who can see and understand it as well. And for them, it will be important.
Have you met them?
No, not yet.
I want to understand more than just colors I can't see.
What do you see?
Sand?
Yes. Imagine if we could look so closely, we could see each grain, each particle. You see, there are patterns in everything. The color in light, the reflections on water. In math, these patterns reveal themselves in the most incredible form. Mm-hmm.
Matt, you not only directed the film, you wrote the screenplay. So you put those words in the script. What did they mean to you, and why did that particular scene describe him for you?
Well, it was a struggle to try to explain how he sees the world, because most of us in here, unless you're a mathematician, it's something that is very difficult to explain and make, and I thought that this scene in particular was important because she plays the audience in this, and mm-hmm. it's an opportunity for him to try to explain a little bit about how he sees mathematics. And patterns was something that Canono, actually, when he was on set, I was asking him about patterns, and it was a way to try to, like, I guess, make it relatable. There was an interesting story that a friend gave me, an article about somebody that had been in the Pacific Northwest and was in a bar fight and got punched in the head, and this was a beer drinking, mullet wearing guy, and didn't really have a lot of mathematical potential, but when he woke up from getting knocked out of this bar fight, he was able to see the world quite differently, and he saw patterns in everything. And I don't think that it's interesting. I think he became more of a savant than necessarily a mathematician that's able to provide tons of creativity to his work. But I did like how he said that he could see crystals and fractals and water, I guess, and different kinds of things. And then that gave me an idea for visually how we could try to show this so that it wasn't just like Sherlock Holmes, you know, flashing numbers every time he's doing numbers. So I wanted to try to find a more organic way to show that, how he sees the world.
It's very beautiful when he talks about colors, but no colors. I mean, yeah. Things you can't see. Does that part of the movie resonate with the two of you?
Yes. Very much, yeah. I was really made to write a movie about mathematics. Obviously a mathematician can't do it. You need someone like Matt to do it. But then Matt has to understand a mathematician and how mathematicians think. And I was just so impressed when I saw Matt's script. He really got us in a way that I just couldn't believe that someone not in mathematician could get that way. And the way he portrays it and explains us in a way that we often couldn't ourselves is really amazing in this movie, I think.
Yeah, for me, that sort of moment was a life-changing epiphany, actually. I was in high school as a freshman, and we were assigned to measure the period of a pendulum, which means how long does it take to swing back and forth. And we had a little stopwatch, and we're making a measurement and plotting on graph paper. This is how long it takes when the pendulum is this long. Make it a little longer, it takes longer. We're making a graph with dots, and it was just supposed to teach us about graph paper. But really, that was what it was supposed to be. Learn how to do graph paper. We're 12 years old, 13 years old. But what I saw was that the dots were falling on a certain shape. It wasn't a straight line like I expected. It was actually a shape I had learned about in algebra class called a parabola. And in that moment, I felt a kind of chilling, like spine-tingling feeling, that as if there were some presence in the room. And there was this sense that there are invisible patterns that you can't see unless you know math. And I really felt like in that moment, a curtain had been drawn back and I was invited into this invisible world. So when Ramanujan says it's colors you cannot see, I get tears in my eyes thinking, that's what I live for, is to try to see those invisible patterns. I don't know how you knew to do that.
And that sounds like another definition of elegance at the same time. Yeah. Let me, we have a few questions from the audience and then we'll give everybody a chance to sum up as well. Question, John von Neumann, thank you. John von Neumann said, mathematicians peak by the age of 26. Mm. Manjul, do you agree?
We're in trouble if so. Yeah. It used to be truer than it is now. People live a lot longer. People live much more longer, productive lives now than they used to just 50 years ago. And so, yeah, I'm pleased to see some of my colleagues who are in their 60s and 70s doing amazing things. And that makes me feel good that I have many years left. But it used to be true. People used to make lists of the best theorems that were proving in the 19th century, and you look at their ages, and they're all, some of them were like late teens, and then some of them were 20s, and maybe you'd hit some 30s and early 40s, but then, it just really dropped out really quickly after that. But now if you look at some of the theorems in the last 25 years, and you look at the list of ages, it really ranges from the 20s to the 60s to 70s, and sometimes even later. So it's really changed.
Apology.
Yeah, Hardy, of course, writes about this, that in A Mathematician's Apology, that Yeah, he thinks mathematicians should basically give up after 40. there's no, and they should work to teach and to write, and that's what he decided to do in a lot of his later life. He wrote books like A Mathematician.
But that was then, as you say.
That was then. It's really changed a lot.
It might be true about the peaking early, but I don't think that's any reason to despair, because just like you could enjoy playing music your whole life, even if you're not Mozart, you know, I mean, even if we're past our prime, it's still a wonderful thing to be engaged in. And
the magic is still there?
The magic is still there, and I can't help but feel, and maybe half the audience is thinking the same thing, that we've only mentioned men's names so far, that where are all the women? Yes. And so I have to think that this can change as we get more women and girls doing math, and also people working on math together. It's a very social thing, in fact, and we constantly talk about the solitary genius, but as you can see, Hardy and Littlewood have a very strong, well, you'll know that if you know the story, but Ramanujan and Hardy have a very strong collaboration with Littlewood. So it is a social thing, and women often are especially good, I mean, compared to some of the men, in these social situations of working together, bringing out the best in each other. So I think that we've got a lot of potential to overturn this old, it was true historically that the best work was done by younger mathematicians, but it doesn't have to be that way forever.
So it's encouraging both in terms of age and gender.
I think so. Yeah.
Okay, another question. I have a sub to this question. Do you believe that the IQ test is still a suitable tool for determining who could be considered a genius? And my question is that what the IQ test is supposed to do? Hmm. Figure out who geniuses are?
Gosh, I don't know either.
Anybody have a thought about the relationship of the IQ test to genius at all?
I think it's really hard to test creativity. So you can test certain things.
Hard to test creativity, and yeah. Genius has such a huge component. The creativity is such a huge component of genius.
Right. Yeah. The TRIPOS examination system at Trinity at that time.
Yeah, people often called it an IQ test.
And it was to determine who the greatest mathematician was, but it would take them, 2-3 years to study for this one test, and they were wasting all their time. So Hardy fought very hard against this because he thought it was a giant waste.
Right, they were teaching a very rigid curriculum. People were just memorizing it and trying to do good on this test to show off their IQ and geniusness. But in the process, they had completely stifled their creativity.
Yeah. How often do parents show up or write you letters, some of those letters with the big letters, with the big capital letters, and say, I've got a kid who's a genius?
Oh, yeah.
How often happens.
That happens, but I think the more poignant thing is how many parents are concerned about how turned off their poor kid is by the way we teach. And I don't blame them, because my kids are 13 and 15 going through school now, and I see them getting systematically turned off. And we're really doing something wrong. I mean, not everyone, and I love teachers. I want teachers to have the freedom to teach the way they can, but there's so
sometimes
many,
they're restricted by very
so
rigid curriculum.
By the curriculum, the test. It's not, I mean.
Everyone can relate.
For anyone who's interested in this one, there's a book that I would recommend. You can find it online as an essay called A Mathematician's Lament by Paul Lockhart, who teaches high school here in Brooklyn and was himself a very fine mathematician. And Lockhart says the problem with math in schools is that we're not teaching any math. That is, we're doing a lot of drilling and rote exercises, and you need this for the test. But you've heard us talk about creativity and art, and you might be thinking, I took math in school. I don't remember any. Did I miss that? Yes, you did. That's the problem.
We need more teachers like the two of you. One more question, and then we will sum up. Can psychological events, that is, thought, memory, be expressed through mathematical equations? Based on your statement that we communicate through prime numbers.
Whoa.
Yeah, deep.
That's a deep one.
Yeah.
We don't know, I think, is the honest answer. Yeah. I mean, it sort of amounts to the question, is the brain a computer? That is, if the brain is a computer, then all of its actions will be expressible in principle in terms of zeros and ones, and then presumably prime numbers. But we're very far from knowing if the brain is really a computer or if there is more there. Serious people think there is more to the brain than just matter. I don't really get that. I kind of think it is a computer, a very subtle computer, but we don't know. Actually.
That connection is very far away still.
Yeah, we don't really know.
Yeah. We need Ramanujan to help us figure it out.
The neuroscience Ramanujan.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's Let me hear some final thoughts from you. Let me start with you, Matt. You said to me earlier, I asked you if you were a mathematician, and you said, no, you can't even figure out the tip at dinner. What do you come away with in terms of mathematicians, in terms of math? Is there something you learned? What did you learn about yourself from the movie?
Ah, oh, well, that's a big question. I've already said it, but I did come to a deep appreciation for mathematicians as artists. And I also came away from understanding how passionate they are. I had no idea. I mean, they love what they do. They're so excited about it, and they've been so supportive of this film. What I've come away from it, learning about, I went deeper into, we've seen a lot of the mathematical clips of the film. There's a whole emotional side to this film that's about understanding people, and a whole human side to this, with two very different people having to learn to get to work together to be able to achieve what they did. And they needed each other. Hardy needed Ramanujan, mm-hmm. and Ramanujan needed Hardy. Mm. Or we wouldn't know who Ramanujan was if there was no Hardy.
That's true.
And
so there's a human story.
There's a human story, but what I learned away most from it, if I had one takeaway, would be that you have to be open as a person and allow people to be able to recognize genius. I mean, this man came from South India at the turn of the century, and the odds that anybody ever knew his name outside of there, or even there, is astronomical.
Figure out what the odds are.
They might be able to, but I think today there's a lot of other Ramanujans out there, and it takes an openness and a willingness to see genius in places that maybe you wouldn't expect it right away.
I love that.
Manjul, what do you want people seeing the movie to go away thinking?
Yeah, well, this movie is definitely a dream come true for so many mathematicians. Because, well, mathematics has been portrayed on screen before, but it's often in the context of craziness. They're crazy people and very stereotypical, not the human side. So we're very, very grateful that we actually get to see mathematicians as humans and get to see their passion for their art, just like other artists have passion for theirs. And so we're so grateful that that the world can get to appreciate the artistry behind mathematics, which is so well portrayed in this film. There are a couple other takeaways. I mean, one is what we were just talking about, that mathematics should also be taught that way as a creative subject. And that's hopefully a takeaway that that teachers will get, and schools will get, and the educational system will get. And finally, there's a very important message that talent can be found anywhere. Mm-hmm. And we really have to make our education system good enough so that anyone can come through. If they're geniuses, we will find mm-hmm. them, and we will be able to nurture their talents and advance their society as a result.
Steve, what about your students? Is there a change over the years? Do you think something like this will make for different students? Do you think this can have that kind of impact on kids?
I hope so. It certainly could. It looks, I can't wait to see the whole movie, but it looks very inspiring and very heartfelt and touching. And I'm sure that will have an impact. I guess the one thought I would like to leave the audience with is, much as we've talked about art and math, it's even bigger than that. I mean, math is so many different things. So if art doesn't move you, there's also, math is very connected to science and to nature. It's a game. My kids find it just satisfying to get the right answer. That is, there's something very satisfying in the manner of crossword puzzle or Sudoku. There's also the social aspect. I mean, it is many, many things. Some people say math is a language. So there are many avenues into it. It's history, it's human connection, it's everything. So that's the message I would like to leave, that don't think of it as some disconnected, annoying subject that you had to do in high school. You were just mistaught, if that's what you thought it was. it's everything that human beings do.
Absolutely, and thank you all for this extraordinary look inside the brains.
Thanks for having me.
It's a very rare opportunity to get this kind of brain power all together And for that, we thank the World Science Festival and the 92nd Street Y. And everybody should go home and just think about being a genius. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you.